Today on the Transplant Helper, we're going to be discussing the differences between a Swan Ganz, a port, a central line, and a PICC line. These four things are often used in and around time of transplant, and so because of that, I believe knowledge is power, so the more we can know about these devices, what their uses are, how they're implanted, the better off we are. So if that interests you in any way, how about go ahead and stay tuned. Hey folks, welcome to Transplant Helper today. My name is Jim Merle. Today we're going to be answering a viewer's question of sorts, and that is basically, Jim, what are the differences between a Swan Ganz, a port, a central line, and a PICC line? I thought it was a very good question. It's one that I've received on numerous occasions. Matter of fact, it's one that I saw just the other day on one of the Facebook groups I'm a member of, and I thought it was a very good question. Now, if you're a believer like I am, that knowledge is power, that the more we can educate ourselves, the better off we'll be, then today's program is just for you. So let me go ahead and encourage you before we begin our discussion today. If you've not already subscribed to this channel, right now would be the perfect time to do that. Go ahead and click the subscribe button right beneath the program, as well as maybe even the bell notification off to the right of that. And that will allow you to receive these programs and be notified as soon as they come out each and every time. I like to publish on Tuesdays and Thursdays, but I throw in a few episodes for bonus as we go. So I hope that you'll do that. This program is all about advocating, educating, and motivating you as a transplant patient and helping you to do the same. So without any further ado, let's jump right in. Let's start with the most invasive of these procedures and move toward the bottom as we go through. Number one, what is a Swan Ganz? Now that's kind of a strange name to have for any kind of medical device or implanted device, but I did want to answer it anyway. And the Swan Ganz is basically also known as a pulmonary artery catheter. And you can hear right in that it's placed in the pulmonary artery. Generally, it's placed right in the right side of your neck, albeit if the doctors have to, they can take a little longer route and come through the left, but nonetheless, the right side of the neck. The Swan Ganz is almost always placed in a surgical area. That is a surgery room, because it has to be done in a completely sterile environment. Generally speaking, when a Swan Ganz is implanted in the body, you're sedated heavily, or maybe even knocked all the way out, if you will, like you would for any other surgery. And they do that, obviously, so not only you don't remember the procedure, but you don't feel any pain while it's going in. And it's kind of complicated to place, and so the doctors really have to take their time, and they really don't need you moving around, or as I would be, probably asking questions while they're going through this. Now, this is also known, the Swan Ganz can also be known as a perpetual catheter. And by perpetual, that just simply means an ongoing continual catheter, or in this case, a cath. And that's much what this is all about. It's just about like doing a heart cath, which should be done through your groin, sometimes through your neck, sometimes through your wrist, and in other areas, they can do heart caths in cath labs. This is used in much the same way, albeit this is implanted over a period of time so that you can keep it over a number of weeks and you can use it while you're in the hospital. And generally speaking, once it's placed, you're sent back to your room, the monitors, the machines are hooked up, and they continually monitor pressures in the heart and or lungs, but particularly and mainly in the heart. Now, these pressures are extremely important, just like the ones that are done in the cath lab, to let the doctors know some major and important information about you. One would be your ejection fraction. One would be the oxygen output and input coming in and out of your heart. Another would be just general heart pressures. As a matter of fact, the Swan Ganz, one of the lumens that comes out of it, and there are about four of them, I think, but one of the lumens or tubes that comes out of the Swan Ganz, generally speaking, has on one end of it, on the inside at least, a little tiny balloon. And on the other end, they usually just really would raise the pressure or expand that balloon by pushing a syringe on the outside of it. Now, what that does during that, and this is one of the major uses for it, what that does is they'll generally have that placed there in that artery. They'll push the balloon and block off a portion or a part, a vein, whatever it is, going in or out of your heart. And by blocking it off, they can then sense how hard your heart is willing to pump or press against that, hence heart pressures are measured. Again, it's so much like an actual heart cath or a catheterization done inside of a cath lab, albeit this is used so you can stay in your hospital room. You're typically bedridden with this, but nonetheless, by then you're probably so sick you don't mind, but you're in your room, you're pretty much flat on your back, they'll let you move a little bit, but the Swan Ganz is placed and it gives them constant measurements of pressures, oxygen levels, cardiac output, ejection fraction, all that stuff. So a Swan Ganz is the most invasive, and it's used for just that purpose, that is being a type of cath. Now, in the next place, or I should say in the next three places, the port, the central line, and the PICC line are often used for exactly the same thing, and that is for the introduction of medications into your body in a very direct way. They're really not a whole lot different than your average IV line you might get in your hand or your elbow, your wrist, whatever, but they do it in a much more permanent way. So let's start with the next invasive of these, and that is the port, oftentimes referred to as the central venous catheter. It is basically placed under the skin, and that is usually done also, like the Swan, is usually done, the ports are placed inside of a surgical area. And that is, again, it has to be extremely sterilized. They have to be very careful. They generally sedate you for this also for the same reason. So you don't know, remember it, you don't have knowledge of it, and so you do not feel the pain. Now, while you're sedated for this, you may not be completely knocked out, but you'll be so heavily sedated, you might probably go to sleep and you certainly won't remember anything. When I place this, generally speaking, what is done with a port is it's a little device, it's a little drum, they call it, about the size of a quarter, maybe a little bit smaller, but it's placed somewhere in generally the right side of your chest, right here on the breast, if you will, placed beneath the skin, but on top of the muscle. Generally, after it's placed, you can feel the little drum. You can rub it. You can feel it. You can kind of squeeze and detect where it is, because connected to that drum is a catheter of sorts that goes up underneath the skin, turns back down, and also goes in that central venous or that pulmonary artery, if you will. It basically, again, delivers medication into your body and gives it to you in a quick way, much faster than a general IV might be in your hand or arm. It delivers medication or spills medicine directly into the heart. Therefore, it is pumped throughout the body very quickly, but it's used for a more peculiar purpose. Now, the reason a port might be placed is because the doctors have determined that you need some type of intravenous type medicine over a long period of time. And typically ports are put in not only in transplant patients, but more likely, more commonly, say for example in cancer patients, or say someone who's suffering with Lyme disease or some chronic disease that's going to go on and need to be treated for a long period of time. Ports can last up to 10 years and they're easily accessible, albeit they're not on the top of the skin, they're underneath the skin. Here's the beauty of that. They're accessed through a needle. So basically you, or typically a home health nurse, whomever, someone at the clinic or hospital, would access that with a needle, again, going into the drum, basically plugging in, if you will, to deliver medication. It may only go in for an hour or two or three, and then they pull the needle out, place a Band-Aid over it, and within an hour or so, you can be back home doing whatever you want to do when you feel like it or if you do, but you can be back moving about, even taking a shower. And that's going to be the divide between this one and the next or the last two that we discuss, and that is with a port. The convenience is it's access with a needle. When the needle's pulled out, you're totally clear to go ahead and shower, go back to activity, exercise, whatever it is you need to do. The port, and when in itself, because it's underneath the skin and the skin protects it, is probably the best one for long-term use, hence why it's used for cancer patients, transplant patients, and many other to deliver long-term medicine. Now, the next one beneath that, not the port, but a central line, is a little bit different. Now, a central line can be done for the same reasons, that is the delivery of medications in a quick, fast, and in a hurry way, but central lines are often placed either in the neck. It'll look a lot like the Swan Ganz when it's placed, albeit it usually only has two or maybe three lumens that come out of it, or ports, but it is placed usually in the neck, running the same path, if you will, right down in the body through heavier veins, and it is meant for the delivery of medications. But it can also be placed, much like the port, in the chest area, pretty much in the same area, stuck there through the skin and then going up and dropping in. The difference being that between a port and a catheter, or if you will, this central line, is that you have the lumen sticking out. So you got little fingers or little lines sticking out that can be basically tapped onto, like a PICC line we're about to talk about, or like a general IV. Now, the difference between that is basically with the central line, whether it's in your neck or whether it comes out your chest or wherever they choose to have it pop out, that one cannot be allowed to get wet. So if you're going to take baths or showers, you're going to have to completely cover that, take care of it, and really just do the best you can. And again, it cannot get wet. Both of these things, the central line as well as the next one coming up, the PICC, have to be cared for by a home health nurse. And we'll say more about that in just a moment. But a central access, central venous access, is what a central line is. Now, in the last place, the least invasive, but for me, it was a lifesaver at the time, there's what's known as a PICC line. And PICC stands for a peripherally inserted central catheter. And by peripherally, it just means basically in the arm. Generally, PICC lines are going to come through the arm. Again, very similar to the central lines, very similar to the ports. The uses are same, but it's placed inside the arm. Now, the beauty of a PICC line on the one hand is that although it's done in a sterile environment, it's generally done right in your hospital room, right in your doctor's office, right in the clinic, wherever you are. You don't have to go into surgery for that. And generally, you're not given any kind of sedation other than maybe just something for your nerves as they deaden the area with lidocaine and then insert it up through your arm. That goes pretty much the same path, goes up through a major vein. There are three to choose from up here in the top of the arm. Goes in, goes around, and drops off into your heart. Now, the downside of this one, if there's a downside, is again, you're not able to shower. You're not able to actually wash the area per se as far as showering baths. You've got to keep it covered, and it has to be cared for on a very regular basis. Generally speaking, that's done by a home health nurse who comes out to your house or wherever you are, but comes in, changes the dressing, being very careful to keep it sterile and clean, covers it back up, bandages it up. And again, you've kind of like that central line coming from your chest. You've got lumens hanging out of your arm that can easily get snagged, pulled, whatever. And if the PICC line gets pulled to any extent and pulled too far out of the heart, gets back up into the vessel, the vein there, it can cause some bad agitation from the medications going in. So it would have to be replaced, pulled out, a new one put in. You go through the procedure all over again. The downside being you can't shower, the downside being you have to keep it cleaned and all of that versus a port, but nonetheless, it is used for shorter term use. As I said a moment ago, the port can be used for up to 10 years. PICC lines are generally supposed to be used under a year. Most people would like, on average, I guess, they probably have PICC lines for 3, 4, 5 months. Something happens, you know, get a little infection, whatever, even if it's just kind of right on the skin, whatever, but they have to be replaced. PICC lines are great, though. I wore a PICC line for 10 months fairly successfully. I had an IV bag tied to it 24/7, but it allowed me to go home and go on about my life. So it was a wonderful thing, really, to have in the long run. So basically, backing up and recapping, a Swan Ganz is a continual or perpetual cath going on. Actually, heart cath for function and for lung function. A port is a very good option for long-term use. Right under the skin, the little drum is placed. It only has to be accessed by a needle, and when the needle is pulled out, you're going about your life. A central line goes in through the neck, can come out the chest in the similar way, but has the lumens coming out, and therefore it has to be clean, washed. Showers are not to be done, but it delivers the medications quickly. And a PICC line, the final one, was the one that goes in your arm. It hangs from your arm. All the similar problems of the central line, except for the fact it's definitely convenient. I know it's one that you can mostly manage for yourself as far as swapping bags, keeping the IV pumps running, all of that. It's a good home remedy to be used about a year or less, if they can. If not, you keep going. It's all good. But nonetheless, I hope this has helped to explain these four things in some way to you, helped to describe them. Again, I say again, knowledge is power, education is knowledge, and so that's what I'm trying to do here on the program, The Transplant Helper. And I hope that you've already chosen to subscribe. If not, go ahead and do that now. Then give me a like or a thumbs up. Share this program out to someone who it may help, because even outside the transplant world, so many people are going to have to deal with these types of things. And I think the information would also help them out. Anyway, until next time, stay stronger, friends.